It's all love. It's all love. It's all love. Only ripe vegetables, fresh fruit and whole wheat. I'm from the old school, my household smell like soul food, bruh. Curry falafel, barbecue tofu. No fish though, no candy bars, no cigarettes. Only ganja, fresh squeezed juice from oranges. Exercising daily to stay healthy. And I rarely drink water out the tap cause it's filthy.
Lentil soup is mento fruit and ginger root is good for the youth. Fresh vegetable with them Ital stew. Sweet yam fries with the green callaloo. Careful how you season and prepare your foods, cause you don't wanna lose vitamins and minerals, and that's the jewel. Life brings life, it's valuable. So I eat what comes from the ground, it's natural. Let your food be your medicine, no accelerant. Strictly herbs generates from the sun, cause I got melanin and drink water. Eight glasses a day, cause that's what they say.
They say you are what you eat, so I strive to eat healthy. My goal in life is not to be rich or wealthy, cause true wealth comes from good health and wise ways. We got to start taking better care of ourselves.
Hello, and welcome to day 4 of Brassica Week. I'm your host, Lane Selman from the Culinary Breeding Network. And today we are joined by Phillip Griffiths from Cornell University, also known as Griff, is here. I'm going to give you a short introduction to him. And then we're going to watch a video that he has put together for us. That's about 30 minutes long about some of the kale breeding work that he's been doing. He's based at Cornell and he does work all over the world really. And breeds vegetable varieties, including brassicas, for us to consume. So Griff is originally from Wales, and he studied, he got a bachelor's degree in genetics at the University of Nottingham. And he tells me that that is the city where Robin Hood is from, in case you don't know. He moved back to his homeland and got a master's degree in plant breeding at the University of Wales. He worked on ryegrass back then. And then he moved to Florida, where he received a PhD at the University of Florida in horticulture and breeding. This is where I met Griff. And if you guys follow on Instagram, you know that I often talk about the back in the day when we were in the Citrus Club together. So we might talk a little bit about that later. We were in the Citrus Club together and went to Central America a couple of times to look at citrus and other crops. Then he started at Cornell in 1999 as a vegetable breeder with a focus on brassicas. He does work in, we were talking about this before we went live, he does work in Australia, in India, in Africa, as well as the US. And he's focused on vegetable improvement for local, national, and international markets, more recently concentrating efforts on quality traits and products more closely aligned with consumer demand. And some of that is going to be in the video that we're going to watch. Griff also participated in the New York City Variety Showcase a couple of years ago, which was really fantastic. So some of you guys watching might know him from that as well. So you guys that are watching on YouTube, I see that there's several people on there right now. I see that you figured out how to use the chat, but if you haven't, there's a little chat box in there. Put your questions in there and I will ask them to Griff after we watch about a 30-minute presentation about his research. Thank you.
Hi from my fake background on Zoom. I'm a vegetable breeder in upstate New York at Cornell University, and I've been working on brassica crops for 22 years now, which is hard for me to believe, at least. Brassica crops are the third most important group economically worldwide, and probably the most important nutritionally. It's been pretty crazy to see how they've been catapulted into popular culture over the last 5-10 years, especially. And those new markets have really opened up a lot of new opportunities, I think. So the title I have is a little ambiguous, and it really refers to some of the efforts I've had in something of a unique position, having been able to work on a lot of different brassica crops and brassica projects over the last 20 years. And it refers not just to the blending or fusion of those projects, but also the idea of moving traits between some of the different market classes, either within the market classes or between the different morphotypes within Brassica or Oleracea. So obviously I've worked on the mainstream Brassica crops for a lot of years, cabbage and cauliflower in particular. But some of the projects that got me interested in more in really some of the diversity that's out there that we can bring in to develop new types, new market classes, started with some efforts on color, but a lot of it was based on work with the leafy brassicas. This is something I started to get interested in around 2007, 2008, when we were doing green bean projects in Kenya, Tanzania, and Eastern Africa. So it started with efforts on African kale or sukuma wiki. Sukuma wiki is Swahili for to push the weak. The traditional types were sort of landrace with an extended internode that are clonally propagated. But these days, African kale is more of a generic term to mean anything from a Portuguese troncuda type to a Georgia Southern collard type. But I decided to start working on the leafy brassicas around this time. And that was aided a lot because a collection of collard landraces was undertaken a few years before in the southeast, ready to add to the Geneva germplasm collection. Charles, who was my PhD student at the time, was very happy about this because the collards really fit into the same type of cooking and taste classes that sukuma wiki and African kale do. So in 2009, we planted out about 200 or 300 different collard accessions and varieties and started to select a lot of the diversity from within them. The following year, we also got supported as part of a large cap project for East Coast broccoli, looking for more sustainable production of broccoli or broccoli varieties that we can grow in hotter climates on the East Coast and diversify production away from California. So we had this sort of over several years, several new brassica projects started to get incorporated and really diversifying the types of products I was working with and the types of efforts we started to focus the breeding on. This was helped then in 2011 when the Atkinson Fund for Sustainable Development funded a project for us to start looking at more diversified crops for Eastern Africa. And this was nice because Charles in the meantime had gone back to Kenya and linked up with a friend of his, Dan, in Western Kenya. And they were interested in trying to initiate and diversify some of the brassicas. Because the sukuma wiki and brassica vegetables are probably the most important, certainly leafy green, but probably the most important vegetable in Kenya. It's standard to the diet almost every day. So that enabled me to link up with a brassica project with Charles and Dan. And that involved also then starting to look at a lot of the market classes of kale that were out there from a variety standpoint. So you had the curly type, the Borico type, like Darkibor, the Tuscan Lacinato type, which have the elongated Savoy leaf, the collard type, the more fleshy, herbaceous types. And then also there's a couple of the jagged type, like fez out there. But basically you have these leafy brassicas that can vary quite significantly in leaf shape and leaf morphology. So we started to look at these in Kenya in 2012, 2013, and started to get some feedback about what they thought about these different types compared to the more traditional collard or Sukuma wiki type. I also got involved with a large food company for the use of brassicas as a natural color in the food industry. Obviously, this is a good thing. And so this involved expanding out to a lot of the different brassica market classes and morphotypes like kale, Brussels sprout, cabbage, and radish, just to look for the different anthocyanin classes and the practicality of using them for the development of natural color. It also initiated a lot of work on working with deeply pigmented brassicas, of course. These efforts really took the program in some different directions. One of them was to start looking at brassicas from a baby green standpoint or internal control environment agriculture production, but also looking at fertigation for how you can also influence the genetic base of the brassicas to have higher or more prominent types of colors. So these different efforts on leafy greens and color and baby greens kind of culminated and started to bring some fairly diverse projects into a sort of common group where we could start looking at traits that exist in different market classes, like the purple pigment or the golden leaf pigment, and how we can combine the market classes and move some of these traits in and amongst those market classes. So that's where the idea of fusion breeding it comes from, taking a trait from one market class and moving it perhaps into another market class. So this whole idea then really opened up a lot of opportunities because brassicas have at least a dozen morphotype groups. And then you have all of the different market classes within those morphotype groups, like Savoy cabbage, red cabbage, flat Dutch cabbage, for instance. And what are the traits that might exist in one market class, for instance, orange trait in cauliflower or a purple trait in kale, and how you can maybe move some of those leaf color, leaf shape or morphotype groups into different market classes of brassicas and create new types and new looking projects. This was done initially a lot on the leafy greens. And it can start generating some pretty interesting results. We generated about 200 hybrids back in 2014. And started looking at the hybrid combinations that look promising as new market classes, but also as a means to advance the F1s and start selecting different colors in different leaf morphologies, for example. So here you can see the brilliant green type with a lower wax or the purple vein or the deep purple coloration by combining pigment genes, for example. In fall 2015, Hannah Swaygarden started her PhD with me, and she's also going to be giving the rutabaga presentation tomorrow. Hannah brought a lot of energy and enthusiasm and was especially interested in better engaging consumers in the breeding process. And so I encouraged her to work in the leafy green area, and then she also started to get much more involved with the food science types of groups like the sensory lab. and really to start looking at how you can look at the organoleptic products and what consumers like, because if you have a new product, are consumers going to be responsive to it or not? So this project formed a base with some of these different looking, different tasting, different colored types of leafy green projects at the early stage, so you can get some feedback, you know, what do people like and why do they like it? And this enabled not just the traditional bringing in the stakeholders to see what they like in a production field, but she set up focus groups and just these sensory feedback study groups to try and evaluate what people really appreciated in these diverse types that they weren't really that familiar with. And it was also nice because we were able to link this back in with Charles in Western Kenya. And Hannah was able to go out a few times and look at the same products in Kenya as we were looking at in upstate New York. So you can get the consumer feedback of people in a different region of the world with a different taste profile expectations, and then really contrast them to see, well, what do people like about collard in the US compared to what do people like about collard in Eastern Africa? It also, just working on a lot of these different morphotypes and colors, started to pivot into getting more involved with the retail side, with engaged food companies and people in the sort of the chefs and just the food business. So we were able to join the variety showcase that Lane set up in 2018. It was in Project Farmhouse in New York, and we demoed the Galaxy sweet tomatoes with high mowin and kale types with Harris seeds with Anne Nunziata at the Natural Gourmet Institute. So here you get some feedback from some pretty diverse groups of people in Manhattan, which of course is a large high-end market, but niche markets have to start somewhere. And it really helps them to get feedback as, you know, what am I doing as a breeder and what direction do we need to go with some of these products? A lot of where this effort has gone has been in the direction of leaf color, because people tend to like something they're familiar with, but a little bit different or a little bit newer. So for instance, this is a new form of lacinato or Tuscan kale. So how does this then compare with some of the ones on the market? We looked at it against Mamba F1, which is a Toza variety this year. Variety that gets a bit of pink into the vein. It doesn't like the heat that much. It did recover a little bit better into the fall. But what you can see is this has much more of the emerald leaf look compared to the traditional waxy blue-green of the lacinato types. So part of it becomes, what do people want when they're more familiar with the dark leafy green type? If you go through to a mid-green type or more of the golden green type that's more maybe familiar with mainstream classes of romaine lettuce, for example. And this is direction that I've been moving some of the materials, some of the colors into established market classes. It also ends up then with a little bit of a trait fusion, because you can move not just the leaf color, but you can move the leaf shape or even the leaf texture. So you can start combining things like a Savoy crinkle leaf with a purple vein and with an intermediate leaf shape. Or you can move, for instance, the emerald leaf color and combine it with the purple vein to diversify the Tuscan or Lacinato market classes. So these are types that have that more crinkle leaf type, which I'm referring as Savoy kale or collard types. And the effort has morphed into looking at what happens when you have these intermediate market classes. Because you can see this is a CMS hybrid that planted this year. So it has the more collard type of leaf, but then it has the more Savoy texture to it. And it's also a CMS hybrid that's very vigorous. So this is something for East Africa, for example, that leaf texture is going to give it a lot more stability in the marketplace. It's going to last a lot longer. But the question is, how receptive are consumers going to be to this type of product? Because it has better black rot tolerance, better bolt tolerance, and it has very good vigor because it's a hybrid. So right now we're looking at these types of trait combinations in the leafy types. Of course, we're also doing this with moving the leaf color into this type. The golden green is a more accepted leaf color in main market classes. So this can definitely add bulk and shelf life into an accepted leaf color if some of the other characteristics for production and consumer feedback are accepted. And you can see my dogs up at the top watching what I'm doing in the vehicle back there. So these hybrids also give a lot of opportunity, because when you work with brassica crops, there's a lot of them are self-incompatible, which makes the breeding more difficult or more complex. But you also have a big drop off in biomass and vigor from the F1 down through about the F4 or 5. So when you start getting to inbred lines, you lose a lot of vigor, because a good inbred line is very different from a good OP. So in this type of case, if we cross this type of selection with the golden type, then we end up with hybrid. Sorry about that. So we end up with a very vigorous hybrid that combines the traits of the two parents. So basically, if you're looking at the two inbred lines as standalones, they're not going to be successful doing much of anything, but the complementation that you get into a hybrid means that you can actually get a very nice looking, very vigorous type of product. And these are products that we're currently testing with both seed companies and some food companies. Another effort is starting to look at these leaf colors and leaf shapes with the baby green markets, because these spring green markets are expanding a lot. You've got vertical farming operations that are expanding a lot. So one of the options is to look at, say, a jagged leaf as an alternate, and also a hybrid between a less attractive jagged leaf and a normal leaf to form sort of an oak leaf hybrid in between. And then how they do, for instance, this is under a heat stress test in California, and this is under a more optimal conditions. And you can see how under the heat stress you get this sort of grayish color, which is a buildup of leaf wax to protect it against the sun UV. So what I've been looking at recently is trying to identify a lot of the self-compatible types, because the self-compatible types that produce a lot of seed are potential as OPs. Ideally, you know, you have them in an earlier generation to have more vigor, but then if you do that, then it's at the expense of some of the uniformity. So ideally you want some vigor and you want some novelty. So we can take things like a jagged leaf or a golden Tuscan type of leaf, or one where you have this sort of golden Savoy with the purple vein, and identify ones that have good seed set, and then start to look these as alternates within the baby green sector. So part of this effort then is starting to bring some of these different traits, like the jagged and the golden or the curl or the purple vein, and then moving them around in different backgrounds among the different market classes. So in a way, you could say it's sort of breaking the brassica stereotype, because you have all of these established market classes in, say, cabbage or cauliflower, but what can you do if you take a trait of interest that might exist in Brussels sprout or kale and move it across to a cabbage or a broccoli, for instance? And also, can you develop a product that has dual purpose, meaning you can use it as both an OP and a baby green? And we're currently looking at this line for that type of market. It's a self-compatible line. It looks great as a baby green. Need to see what the seed economics are. But it also looks good just from a contrast, having the a little bit of curl with the golden leaf, but then having a very prominent purple vein with a single gene that doesn't bleed into the leaves like a lot of the color genes you have in current kale types. So obviously we're still looking at the main market class types. In the leafy greens especially, the main market class type is the Boricol type, Darker Boar, Winter Boar, Star Boar. So you have something like Darker Boar. We're looking at hybrids. This is one we're testing currently. The main difference with Darker Boar here is that this has a lot more curl. It's a little bit lighter green color and it's a little bit softer in texture. So it's got a little bit less of that fiber in it. And then if you look at, say, Red Boar, which is not really known for good consumer attributes, trying to tone that down and having a much more curly, soft red combination. So this is where you're kind of like combining within a market class. It's more of an intra-market class trait combination to get some better consumer traits. Collard is the type that we started on the earliest, so a lot of these materials are probably closest to commercialization right now. I've been doing a lot of work with the golden leaf type over the last 10 years, moving it into a lot of different market classes, making it more heat tolerant. Also continuing to look at and work with the development of just standard Georgia Southern type collard hybrid alternates to products like Top Bunch or Tiger. But also starting to look at how we can combine, say, the color genes to have a much more intense type. And this really comes from an effort of combining a lot of market classes. The deep purple type is actually the combination of germplasm with cabbage, Brussels sprout, and kale backgrounds. So you have different genes with different alleles for anthocyanin production. But if you can get the right combinations, you can get this really intense deep purple look. It has a cost on biomass, but it can be, of course, very attractive from a consumer standpoint. So this has just led to sort of diversification of market class efforts, I suppose you would say. The standard Boricol being either this dark green or blue green curly type, or moving towards the red scarlet Red Boar type. But then what if you start taking it in the direction of having more of a golden leaf in the curl or more of a deep purple in the curl? So this is a work in progress, and it's not just curly kale we have these efforts in. It's also, you know, trying to develop new types of broccoli beyond things like Violet Queen, that is not a particularly good OP with some purple coloration, or moving into sort of Tuscan broccoli, golden broccoli type, or head, what I would call a crown sprouted type of broccoli, which is sort of intermediate to a crown broccoli and a sprouting broccoli. So where are we with the development of these? Part of it depends on when we started the effort. Breeding takes a lot of time, especially in brassicas. We're starting to get to a point now of testing some of the rosé cabbage types, which are the ones that are intermediate to red and green. They're quite interesting. They have the sort of watermelon look on the inside, but they're not as fibrously as regular red cabbage. Now they have more of that crispness of a green cabbage, and developing these in just the regular rosé cabbage and rosé savoy type. So you can see this is just one that we brought in for seed production, where you just cut it back and it has just a much, much lower level of pigment within the head. So these are materials we're now going to be starting to send out for testing in 2021 and 2022. Radish was also an effort that was initiated back in 2006 with Colour. It became part of the Natural Colour Project. So we actually brought these colors in from germplasm, not just from the watermelon radish types. And this is really a movement from more of a field radish or pigmented field radish into salad radish types. So these are types that you would harvest at about the 1-inch size. Selecting and developing these where you have the pink salad radish, the internal red, the internal purple, and the fully purple. And what's interesting about these is they develop the color outside of stress. A lot of time when you have the internal colored radish, they you grow them into September where you have a bit of a cooling period, and that enhances the coloration of them. So right now we have a big effort on a lot of different color and leaf types. That's really the blend or fusion of all of these different brassica projects. And it's really about seeing how people respond to these, depending on both the leaf color, the leaf texture, and the leaf morphology. And that's really the next direction that we want to be moving in. I've got a reasonably big effort heading into this summer with multi-hybrid blends in four of the leafy types. And if that's successful, it's something I'd like to engage with a number of people on trying to advance that. It's based on quite a few years' work, but it's forming new blends of golden collard, regular collard, golden savoy kale, and regular savoy kale. And this is something we're currently working on and will advance through the 2021 season to have our initial products for testing in 2022. But it gives an example of where you can go with brassicas if you try just some different things, because you can basically take some traits that have a level of popularity from one market class, and it may just be one or a small number of genes, and just move it across to another class and just diversify and expand the types of varieties and products that are available. So that's where I'm kind of coming from, this idea of fusion breeding. And we'll see if anybody has any questions, which I'm happy to answer during Brassica Week next week. In the meantime, I'm heading into a COVID winter here in upstate New York, which is a little bit different from this background, which is, I think, Mombasa in Eastern Africa from a few years ago and more exotic times. So thanks for listening, and I'm going to stop the video.
Okay. Thank you, Griffy, with us. Oh my gosh. That was fantastic. I have to be honest that I did not have time this week to watch this before right now. And it was absolutely fantastic and really interesting. We have a lot of questions here.
I can't start my own video.
You want to start another video?
No, I'm not able to link on video from my end.
Oh, okay. It's we can just do it like this if you want. There's a picture of you up here, or no? There we go. Not sure if there's anything ABBA can do to help. There you go. There you are. Okay. Back in Africa. That was great, Griff. I mean, really interesting work that you are doing. And of course, I heard about it and known about a lot of this work. Like you said in the presentation, you showed some of that at the, you know, at the Variety Showcase. And I knew about Hannah's work when she was a graduate student with you. I was writing on questions, and then I was also looking at, I've got another screen here, looking at YouTube and seeing a lot of the same questions. So I'll just jump into those. A lot of people would like to know, what did you find out? Like, what did you find out from US consumers? I guess if they can be all lumped together, considering like in Ithaca versus, you know, New York City, I guess if they're different, but US consumers versus African consumers about what they like as far as all of these phenotypes being, you know, the color, the texture, the flavor, like what is it that you found that people were drawn to here and then also as well as in Africa?
I mean, a lot of that was central to Hannah's PhD, who's talking tomorrow, who would be much better at actually answering that question. There are differences for sure. I mean, I've been going back and forth to Africa for 15 years. There's some variability in the leafy greens there generally. People normally just respond to them as sweet or bitter in quality, but they also like the larger leaf, deep green. They see if it's more of a yellow color, it's nutritionally deprived. And if it's more of a blue-green, it's more stressed. So people eat it almost every day in Kenya, Sukuma Wiki. And there's about four categories in Africa when people describe things. So if you have a watermelon, for instance, it's either sweet, very, very sweet, or incredibly sweet. It's the same, the beer would be cold, very, very, very cold, or incredibly cold. So people can tell intrinsically by just looking at the color and the type. In Kenya, the preferred one is much more of an heirloom landrace. So people refer to Sukuma Wiki from the Kisi area as being very sweet and high quality. And the reason for that largely is that it's clonally propagated. It's sucker propagated. It doesn't really go to seed. Mm-hmm. So it lacks vigor. But then people have started to become introduced now to hybrids like Mafalmi. With things like Tuscan kale, there's an amount of suspicion because it doesn't look like the type of products people are used to, or even curly kale. But I think people are very open. If you look at Mafalmi, it has some savoy in the leaf to it. And that's become an incredibly desirable trait for them. It gives more integrity to the leaf, better shelf life, and people generally like that. So it depends on the consumer, because it depends also if you're talking about collard or kale. The US market is more kale, which is salad based. And that's more related to the leaf texture, because kale, you want the volume, obviously, to make it look better. You don't want flat leaves, and also to hold the dressing. But the texture also gives it the crunch, the texture, etc. So the US consumer generally is more familiar with kale. The people in Kenya are more familiar with what's more of a collard type. A lot of what's sold as Sukuma Wiki now is basically Georgia Southern collard. So it overlaps with Southeastern collard consumers in how it's prepared, I suppose. But it's really a question for Hannah. There's similarities and there's differences.
Yeah, and speaking of how do they eat it in Kenya? I mean, they cook it down in like more like you see in the South in the US, where it's cooked down collards?
No, because I mean, in the Southeast, you'll have people with bacon fat and brown sugar, etc. In Africa, it's it's chopped up, and then it's just a small pan with a little bit of oil, a little bit of salt, and it's just seared for a couple of minutes. Okay. And it really doesn't taste like you would think of brassica, like a cabbage, because it's all pretty much fresh. It's picked through the market the same day as it's consumed. Okay. And it's sometimes mixed as well with other leafy greens. Like in Tanzania, they'll mix Ethiopian mustard with sukuma wiki.
Okay, Hannah's actually on and she answered the question. So she says that in general, Kenyan participants had much more stringent expectations of their sukuma wiki as they were consuming it 4 or 5 times a week. They did not like any crosses between collards and curly or boar types of kale.
In the original tests we did, they were quite open to beira, which is a beijo type that's more of a Portuguese tronchuda. Mm-hmm. Has a much stronger stem, a little bit of a leaf curl, but that variety seemed to change over the last few years. But it cooked in it, it retained color after cooking, which was also important because when you cook it, it can turn brownish color pretty quickly.
Yeah.
The ones that just maintain that bright green color after cooking for a period of time is very desirable aesthetically.
And then she goes on to say, but in upstate New York and in Kenya, the participants seem to be open to crosses between collard and broccoli types. Yeah, the color thing too, I mean, even before cooking, just looking at it, this is what I was going to ask you, and then someone also brought it up, is like, are people, and again, it might be for Hannah, but it's like, what do they think about this kind of yellow color? Because I feel like anybody who's worked in farming, our initial reaction is like, that plant isn't healthy, and then it kind of transfers to consuming it is not going to be so healthy. I mean, that's my initial reaction. So, and what nutritional value is associated with the different color categories that you work with? You know, I mean, there's more anthocyanin in the purples. Is there a big difference in the nutritional content?
With the golden, you have to do quite a lot of work breeding out some negative traits from it. It tends to be pretty sensitive to heat, and that gives it a grayish color. So you have to go for the shiny types and the more heat tolerant types, the ones that maintain that quality through heat. You also have to kind of move to the hybrids, but the Savoy type improves it quite considerably. We tested with a fairly large food company in the Northeast that does chef pickup meals. And they really liked the golden Savoy type. And part of it was, because it has some similarities aesthetically with chard, but it doesn't have the bitterness. And it was something from their standpoint that picked and boxed well and had a milder taste and flavor. And so it's anecdotal and it's early because it's new material that's just getting into the product development line. But they were interested in, do you have seeds so we can grow 2 acres of it this year? Of course, it's still moving along, but you get some aesthetic benefits with the leaf color. You move to that more mainstream golden green salad like you have with arugula, romaine, etc. But the importance is really the volume and the texture that you have in the leaf. So that's why I think having that in there takes it really to the step it needs to be, where golden collard really doesn't have that. We did get some nutritional data back on the different types with Carl Sams from Tennessee, who ran some materials. And it was interesting to see some variabilities in the different market class with respect to glucosinolates, for example. Mm-hmm. But that's the type of thing that just needs a lot more work. Nutrition is anecdotal as well, to an extent. The different color is going to have a different profile, but it's going to have higher levels of some phytochemicals, lower levels of others. So it all really depends on what you're measuring. And that varies based on biochemical pathways for carotenoids, for example. But I think aesthetically, the golden has more of a place in the salad market than it does in the collard market. And to move to the salad market, then you have to have the volume and the leaf texture. That's where the Savoy comes in. And then you're moving in where you replicate what consumers are more used to from a color standpoint.
I'm thinking of two different questions that are very different from one another, but I guess one, I want to ask you about the kale craze, because this came up when we're talking about on Tuesday, we had a breeder from Italy talking about some brassicas that they have there that are very specific to the small area that they are in. That is not well known here at all. And just talking about like, how is it that a particular vegetable kind of goes viral, you know? I mean, I think we're seeing it a little bit with like pink radicchio. And by the way, those lavender rose, you know, cabbages are awesome. And like, it's that kind of like pop that people are just going to go nuts over, I feel like, just aesthetically.
Yeah, Syngenta tried patenting CMS F1 pink cabbage about 15 years ago. So that patent will be up in 3 or 4 years, but it doesn't cover OPs. And it only covers within a range. So I do have some I want to test next year, which are pink Savoy cabbages, which
that would
because then you get that little bit of crinkle and they tend to be sweeter as well. So I think those will be really nice. And I've got several selections of those that should be fixed going through to next year. But the kale craze is interesting because I visited the Netherlands a couple of times about 5 years ago. And, you know, Bejo had developed some kale hybrids a number of years ago, and they had fairly low sales. And then suddenly within 2 or 3 years, the volume was tenfold. And they were just, people in the Netherlands just couldn't understand why kale was selling so much volume in the US. And just, you know, is this something that's there to last? I see it more as a follow-on from the internet and smartphones and communication, and also a movement to more complexity in what people want. So, you know, people don't want an orange juice anymore. They want a mango, papaya, and grapefruit juice. They want everything in one, and kale has a different crunch than most of the crisper leafy greens. It also falls more into the main meal market as opposed to the starter salad. And then where you have the traditional salads, the crisp salads like lettuce that go with cucumber, onion, etc., with a fairly simple dressing, kale seems to complement a much wider range of ingredients with it, with the dried cranberries and the toasted coconut and so the kale salad just becomes a different eating experience. And I think it falls into the more complex sort of taste sort of cascade, I suppose, or blend. But certainly it's taken off like crazy. And of course you've got the nutrition element to do it. So.
Yeah, I mean, I was saying on Tuesday, I have some vegetable, you know, books that are just like, they're cookbooks, but they go through and they talk about each different vegetable. And it's not even very old. I mean, it's from, you know, it is from the 90s, but that's not that old. But it just talks about kale. And it says kale, it's like you have to cook it to eat it, you know? It's like, I'm like, it's already completely outdated, you know? I'm like, wow. So it's been really amazing to see this take off like this.
Everyone in Europe basically boils it. And the benefit of kale is you continue to cook it without ruining it. So, you know, it's harder to overcook. And that's why they couldn't understand the US market, which is much more salad focused, and where really kale took off, because in Europe it was just the boiled side.
Right. Yeah. In Italy, they always say, they're like, first we boil it and then this thing. Someone wants to know, we got a lot of farmers that are watching, and someone wants to know about the radishes and when they're going to be available.
Well, the radish project is interesting. It's one that actually started back in 2006. It's about 15 years so far in the making. It's never been a front project. It's always been the sort of bench at the back of the house. So I have, I initially had eight that I focused, and we've cut that down to four, which are red, all purple, interior red and interior purple. And we're trying to do a cage increase with a seed company this year to see how it produces with the seed. I've also made crosses to advance another cycle to try and improve the type. They're obviously they're not perfect compared to radish that people have worked on for 20, 30 years, because you're doing something really very different, because the interior colored ones now are typically the Chinese ones that are used for the natural colors, or things like watermelon or the Bordeaux types, which tend to be these big field radish that you grow into September, and they get the interior color when you get the cooling period later in the season. These are ones that you can grow basically to the sort of 1-inch salad size. And even if you're in a greenhouse, you don't need stress to get the color. You do tend to get a little bit more fiber with the darker purple ones. And you also get a growth penalty when you have high levels of anthocyanins. So for instance, if you grow a red cabbage, you never get the vigor that you do in a green cabbage. When you have the high color, it's a selection which interferes with the movement of carbohydrates, and they end up in carbon sinks that convert to anthocyanins. And you end up basically with about 80% of the yield that you do with the greens. And that's typical. So the higher pigment you have, you get a little bit less on the biomass. So they'll grow a little bit slower than something that's just colored on the outside. So the first thing we have to find out is how do they do for seed production? And then if that's successful, we can do some test marketing in this year to see if they're functional. Because it's something you'd have to grow in a different way. They're not going to have quite the vigor of the regular radish. They're going to grow a little bit slower. So if you're talking about 4 weeks with a regular, it might be 5 or 6 weeks. And they're a little bit more turnip shaped, like a little bit more geospherical. And so they are sort of a new product, and it's the sort of thing that evolves over time and improves over time. So do you get to a point where you have something that is good enough to go out there, or do we have to go through another cycle? So potentially 2022, if they produce seed and they look decent, otherwise probably more like 2025.
Okay. Most of your stuff, does it get released through, like, would it be in like high mowing areas, some of your things? Like,
That's where I'm moving now, because I've got much more into the quality element and the diversity element. Historically, I've moved material through the major companies where it just gets buried into their programs. Mm-hmm. So now we're testing with a lot of the secondary catalog companies, the sort of Johnny's High Mow in Panam type of operations, as well as obviously the big companies. And it depends on the product. Mm-hmm. Because if it's something like broccoli, then we'll work with companies like Bayer and Bejo. But if it's something like a rosé Savoy cabbage, then that's just something that would be, well, that's just too much of a niche product. We would never hold it. And, you know, at what point does something cease to become a niche product and become a mainstream? Because mainstream products start off as niche products. Mm-hmm. Even something, I was walking through the field with somebody from a large company last year, and they mentioned that even the curly kale, something like Dark Epoch, be considered niche, even though it sells 2-3 million in seed. So yeah, I'm doing both CMS hybrids, but on the more mainstream markets, because the people who are going to back those are not going to want something that's a little bit more off type from what people are familiar with. People want something that's familiar but different. Mm-hmm. So taking something like a a rosé cabbage. Then people are familiar with green cabbage and red cabbage, and now you have the sort of rosé type. So it's just a color change. But I have a flood of materials coming down the pipeline that would fit a lot of organic type markets, OP markets, and blend markets, as well as the larger company hybrid markets, a lot of materials. And that's why it's good to, I think, get feedback from people and involve the consumer, because you can put a lot of effort into something that is just not going to make it in the marketplace.
Well, I hope that we can get back to having in-person things soon. And I have some more variety showcases that are going to be in different parts of the country planned for the next few years, and give you like 5 tables. And then you can just show off all of them. It'd be great. I have a question about like the glossy waxy differences in brassicas, and like, what does this mean for flea beetles and aphids? Do you see any resistance or more attractiveness to in certain types?
The two biggest problems with the golden are that it can be sensitive to heat, and it's also highly desirable for flea beetles. And when you have more of a glossy leaf, it becomes even more desirable again. So the production of the golden ones is going to be more challenging for organic unless you cover them. Mm-hmm. I think you get probably some benefit when you move to the Savoy type, but both the golden and the glossy are big attractants for flea beetles. Mm-hmm. And they could be problems in certain markets, but it depends where you grow them, how you grow them. Where we are, flea beetles tend to come in 2 waves, and you can protect them probably through the first wave by cover, which tends to come about late June. And depending on planting time and age of harvest, you can probably work around it by just how, where, and when you plant things. And it depends where you are. Mm-hmm. Also, I tested some of the golden in India, and they also have a lot of flea beetle problems. And they said it would be a killer for their markets. Mm-hmm. Because they would get swamped by that. But yeah, you don't know until
right. I just was asking, because in onions, you know, with the glossy types, they don't get thrips so much, but they just get hammered with thrips out here if you have like the waxy types.
Yeah, and the wax also depends on the climate that mm-hmm. you grow it in, because the more stress you have from UV, the more wax you have. So even if you have the more glossy type, and you know, you go from completely waxless to highly waxy, and that comes into the heat sensitivity, because it's genetically how much glossiness do you have, and then how much is that influenced by the time of the year you put them out. Mm-hmm. So if you put them out early enough or late enough, then you don't get the waxiness of the leaves that you would in, say, July and August at their peak.
Another question I was thinking of too, we're getting close to time, but I wanted to ask if you were working on anything that heads and also has really tasty, usable leaves. So cauliflower with tasty leaves, or, you know, broccoli, anything where you're, you know, it's a multi, you know, use all of the product, all of the plant.
Yeah. A few, certainly, Tuscan broccoli, where you harvest the leaves as a lacinato or Tuscan kale, and you harvest the broccoli crown. And that's an idea that's been out there for a long time, where you have sort of more collard type of leaves in a broccoli or cauliflower, for instance. But they are more in the earlier stages, mm-hmm. I suppose. Definitely doing some different things with broccoli and cauliflower, and also looking kind of moving into the middle ground of markets, because you tend to have the highly specialized CMS hybrid companies, or you can have OPs that can be a little bit variable or lack some quality. And can you get something in the middle? And that's something we're trying to develop now as an offshoot from the East Coast Broccoli Project, taken a combination of essentially field crop polycross breeding with OP breeding and hybrid breeding and having a blend of approaches. And it will start off with 6 inbred lines proven in development of hybrids that have all of the quality characteristics you'd want in ground cup markets and creating multi-hybrid blends. So essentially an East Coast blend. Mm-hmm. And that's something I hope to have going out for seed increase in August.
Okay.
Testing next year. And I think it would be a really nice option for broccoli that would give a much higher quality product that is going to work more in variable markets, but doesn't fall into that CMS hybrid trap. Mm-hmm.
Okay, 2 more questions. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Someone said that imperfect produce is beginning to trend, that this off-type brassica or other types of off-type produce could start flying with the right crowd, or fly starting with the right crowd. And then the question is, what are the off-type kind of brassicas that you were thinking about?
Off-type brassicas in respect of color, shape, size, age. I mean, the one image I showed during the presentation, the H46 is an interesting type because it has the golden glossy leaf, mm-hmm, with a vein color that doesn't bleed into the leaves like a lot of the pigments do, because you have 3 to 5 different pigment genes and different alleles with anthocyanins. So it's one that has a very striking look. What we're finding now, because we're increasing that in the off season with a partner company, and what we want to do is find out what the seed production of it is. Because if the seed production is high, it would make a fantastic baby green. If the seed production is not so high because it's semi-incompatible, then it falls more into that bunching market, farmer's market. And the sales are not going to be as high, I don't think, in the mature game as the baby. But it is an element of, you know, brassicas, you have maybe 10 different morphotypes. You know, the axillary buds of Brussels sprouts, the terminal bud of a cabbage, the floral inflorescence of the halted floral inflorescence of cauliflower. But even within those, you have multiple market classes. So cabbage, you know, you have sweet up cabbage and flat Dutch cabbage and Savoy cabbage and storage cabbage. So you end up with, you know, probably over 100 different market classes with brassicas, but they tend to have been focused based on certain characteristics. And I think it's what I allude to with the fusion breeding, is these are all the same species, but you can take a trait that's in one of those market classes and just move it to another one of the market classes. Mm-hmm. And you can really have some pretty interesting results from that. But you also need to keep it within the element of familiarity, because if you do too much all at once, mm, then people aren't sure, you know, how you prepare it, what you do with it, et cetera. So it is that element of, you know, as a breeder, you look at these things and think of the possibilities, but you have to really pass them by both retailers and consumers and just people who are generally in the supply chain to get their feedback of what may be interesting and what may not, because you can get very, very, very quickly in breeding. So it's important not to fall in love with things, and if they're not going to work, to just move on and focus your efforts on what is going to work. Yeah. I've had a lot of products where you have high hopes and you take them so far, and it's just, it comes to a point where this isn't going to work. Mm-hmm. It's about what you throw away, not about what you keep oftentimes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the last thing is a conversation that I have with a like an organic distributor here, really is wanting more to see more colorful cauliflower on the market because it flies off the shelf, right? It's like something that pops on the shelf in the wintertime and they love it in order purple, and then like the yellow, orange, and then green. Unfortunately, green's my favorite, but whatever. and always whatever I like is always like the last in the list. But so they like these a lot. You know, growers have a really hard time with the post-harvest handling, and meaning that they just get bruised a lot and they don't look good. Are you working on that? Do you have anything, suggestions?
I don't work so much on cauliflower now. I did a little bit more. I do some work in India, and my predecessor was the one that came up with the orange cauliflower initially, Mike Dixon. And that's something that you can't generate as an OP because it's a homozygous gene that causes a very tiny runty plant. So you have to combine it with an off-white type to produce the orange. So that has to be a hybrid. And it's also a lot more difficult to produce seed of and a lot more expensive to produce seed of. So this can tend to be a problem because seed of orange cauliflower can end up being a lot more expensive than seed of regular cauliflower. And people like the orange, but they don't want to pay any more for the orange cauliflower than they do for the mm-hmm. white. There are ones that I've seen out there. I think I saw a white Romanesco a couple of years ago that looked very interesting.
Yeah.
So there are those opportunities and differences that are out there with the cauliflower market for sure. It depends where you're located as well. I mean, obviously in India, it's the main brassica consumed, and the three primary categories are tropical cauliflower, semi-tropical cauliflower, and temperate. And that all really relates to rainfall and climate. So if you're in somewhere like Bengaluru, you're going to grow subtropical cauliflower. If you're up in the northern parts of India during the off-season, you'll grow temperate. But a lot of the season is hot and rainy and a lot of disease. So you want something that's just going to run through very, very quickly, like tropical cauliflower. And a lot of that, but half of that market is OP, even in India still. So there are those sorts of variations that could occur because a lot of the Dutch companies will focus on very particular product types, you know, these big 8-pound cabbages that are rock solid and last for 2 years in storage, where there can be a lot more to it than that. And I think quality plays into that a lot, both aesthetically and for the type of product it is. I mean, I think that's why something like a pink Savoy cabbage could be quite interesting for, say, the organic community, because Savoy cabbage is one of the ones that will actually fall into the bagged salad market. Mm-hmm. Brassica tends to have that sort of sulfur type of smell to it if it's bagged. Some of them have lower levels of glucosinolates. Some of them are sweeter. Some of them have more texture to the leaves. So you see in supermarkets now some bagged salads that are using cabbage in place of other leafy greens. And mm-hmm. I think that tends to be more Savoy cabbage because it's got that more yellowish color with the texture to the leaf. Mm-hmm. So you have that element when you bring in the sort of rosé type into that type of product, I think. And you also end up in between because red cabbage tends to be a bit more fibrously, green cabbage a little bit more crisp. So the pink, you maintain some of the crispness of the green, mm-hmm. but you have that aesthetic quality of the color without it being that sort of deep purple color. And it's got that nice watermelon look, you know, with the green leaves on the outside, and then you cut it open and then you've got that sort of crisp rosé leaf.
We don't want them replacing radicchio in these salad mixes. Gotta keep radicchio there too. But yeah, thinking about that Napa, I can't remember the name of it right now, that Johnny's carries, the purple Napa cabbage that is really pops. You know, people just love purple and pink things, I feel like, right now.
Yeah, and I think that the pink has a lot of benefits for yield and crispness. If you go too far on the pigment, it tends to be more fibrous. So it tends to erode the consumer quality, the deeper color, even though you have that sort of intense color, which can be attractive. In baby greens, you don't get that so much. So there's also different markets depending on the stage at which you harvest it and the type of crop you harvest, I suppose. But there's a lot of opportunities in color. Even Pan Am, the new motto is color the world.
Oh, yeah. Well, this is fascinating. I really appreciate you sharing all this with us and just the work that you do to keep our, you know, vegetables colorful, beautiful, exciting, you know, getting people, it just gets people really excited about eating vegetables when they look, you know, stunning, when they taste good, obviously. So thanks so much for doing all this work.
It's also the most important component of food. Is it's the one thing that binds us all. It doesn't matter what your wealth is, what your age is, what your religion is. Everybody can come around and appreciate good food, no matter where you're from. So it is truly global.
Yeah, I love those pictures of you in Africa eating with your friends there.
That's at the Hippo Point in Kisumu. I've been there a number of times.
Well, I'm going to dig up the pictures of us in Central America, and I'm going to post them as soon as I can find them. And then when COVID is over, we can have a reunion tour. So we got to find everybody. You can find Courtney and Betsy easy, but we got to find all of our other friends and head down there from the Citrus Club reunion.
I love cabbage. But
everyone's saying thank you. There are a lot of people on here that really enjoyed it. A lot of comments, and then it'll be posted. Everyone knows all of these are posted. They're recorded. They're posted afterward, and we're getting a lot of people watching them after the fact, more than that are actually on right now. But there are lots of happy, excited people. So thank you so much, Griff.
No worries.
Okay. Take care. See you guys tomorrow. We'll talk rutabagas with Hannah, who is a former PhD student of Griff's.